Doing good. Doing good. A few different things to announce here real quick. One is a quick video from Superintendent Mark. I can hear her squealing over here. Woof. That's nice. Yeah, things are possessed. Anyway, so Superintendent Mark sent a message out. He wants some of the churches in the California region, the Network of Undeniable Blessing, as it's called, to give a shout out to the churches in Myanmar, aka back in the day, Burma. And so I want you to watch the video super fast, what Mark's hoping for. Roll tape.
Inviting you to share with our sister conference in Myanmar a simple phrase, Mingalaba, which means bless you. It's a common greeting in Myanmar, in order to encourage them as they have their annual conference in just a couple of weeks. Iglesia de Restauración Familiar in Redwood City did a great video with everybody saying Mingalaba. And it's your turn. Take a minute. Just turn that little camera on your phone to your face right now and say Mingalaba from wherever you are. And I will put that together as a greeting for our friends. So please encourage your brothers and sisters in Christ suffering under military junta with a life that's more extraordinarily difficult than almost anybody in the USA can imagine. So please encourage them with Mingalaba.
We're going to do a little practice here. So we're going to shoot for something like Mingalaba from Fernley. So, okay. And then you guys either stand out there or stand behind me. I'll spin the camera around. Okay, yeah. So we'll go to a count. Just one more test. So it was like 3, 2, 1. Okay, so this is the real one. And Mingalaba from Fernley. Okay, one more time. 3, 2. What they said. All right, well done. Well done. Potluck Sunday, be prepared. It's also Communion Sunday for those at home who wish to participate in our communion service. If you can find some appropriate items, please do so. We'll sing our songs, discuss communion, and then go right into our fellowship dining. Any other questions or announcements?
It's time for board members.
I already mentioned at the end of the month we have our big society meeting. We elect members. We reinstate positions in the church. Some people get kind of tired of doing what they're doing, and we could use some new fresh blood in there, different things. Some people could use a person to come alongside and just help them. You become an assistant to somebody. It takes a village to run this place. From the cleanings to the preparations to the, keeping the doors on and things. So watch what people do. Some potluck, people help with potluck. Learn how to help with potluck. If you notice in the morning, somebody puts out the banners and the pinwheels and the things. Can't leave them out all week because they won't be there next week. We need help with those things. People to learn other people's positions. Even something like that, when they're not here, it's nice to have someone who knows how to do it. I'd like to find more people that would like to learn how to run a sound system or the video. There was one week when, Stan and Adam and George were all gone. That was a rough week. And then, so that's coming up. Pray for our meeting. Consider helping, filling in some way or another. Anything else? Time to sing songs to the Lord.
Good morning.
Thank you. enough. Your grace is enough. Your grace is enough for me. Your grace is enough. Your grace is enough. Your grace is enough for me. So remember your people, remember your children, remember your promise, O God. Your grace is enough, your grace is enough, your grace is enough for me.
Enough, heaven's reaching down to us. Your grace is enough for me. God, I see your grace is enough. I'm covered in your love. Your grace is enough for me.
Please have a seat.
God tells us that his grace is enough for us, and it is. I'm sure that during the snow day this week, many of you saw guys from the church out shoveling driveways, and it was a wonderful thing to see. We have a wonderful church here. We have wonderful people who just work hard for the Lord, and God's grace is enough. Bow your heads with me in prayer. Lord, we consider all that you've given us, all that you do for us, all that you have provided for us, and we are humbled in your presence, Lord. We have so much in this country that we don't even appreciate because it's possible we haven't experienced anybody else's country or their way of living. But Lord, we just thank you for all that you've done for us. Thank you for the snow. Thank you for the rain when it comes. Thank you for the moisture. Thank you for the warmth of our homes, for potluck Sunday when we can all share food together. Thank you so much for just being who you are. And Lord, I pray that we won't disappoint you today, but today we will do everything in our power and your power to be everything you want us to be. And we ask this in your name. Amen.
If you like, please stand with us.
Worthy is the
sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. I will adore you. Filled with wonder, awestruck wonder, at the mention of your name. Jesus, your name is power, breath of living water, such a marvelous mystery. Yeah. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is and is to come. All creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. You are my everything, and I will adore you.
Show me your way, show me your glory. As we sing, show me your heart, show me your way, show me your glory. Show me your heart, show me your way, show me your glory. As we sing, show me your heart, show me your way, show me your glory. Show me your heart, show me your way, show me your glory. Show me your heart, show me your way, show me your glory.
Please have a seat.
I would like to thank many people who helped with snow removal. Terry was there, Bob was there, Bob's son Bobby was there. And while I did most of the work, I'd still like to throw them a little something. No, it was an ordeal. I mean, that was 15, 20, some people claim 20 inches of snow. Many people saw the picture I posted on Facebook of my bird bathometer. There's just this round tube of snow coming straight out of the bird bath. I did notice a few things, and we couldn't make it to everybody's house. That much snow, I got tired quick. You know, if it's 2 inches of snow, I can do 10 houses. If it's 20 inches of snow, one house. You know, that's kind of the way it works. I'd like to thank all of you who had your driveways done by the time I got there. You may not know it, but I drove by Fred's house. I drove by Leslie's house. Yours was done nice. Did you pay someone for that? You did that? And then I also noticed cleaning people's driveways whose houses don't face north is much easier. So if many of you could move, that would help. Steepest driveway in the world goes to Sue Gill. Wonderful, wonderful award there. Anyway, no, it was neat to have the guys get together and help and find people helping each other. And in fact, we even did some random neighbor. Gal was out there struggling away. We just ran over there and did hers too. To me, that's like church. You know what I mean? That's like, who are you guys? Where'd you come from? Oh, our church members, you're an extra neighbor. What church is that? Well, I'm glad you asked. Yeah. Yeah. So today I want to talk about, and thank you all for playing along with the Mingalaba Burmese greeting. Thank you. I want to talk about some stuff that's very, I don't know if controversial is the right word, but it's convoluted is not the right word. Complex, maybe. And it has to do with when you get a bunch of people together to discuss anything, right? This is human nature when it comes to any particular topic there is. Now, oftentimes I talk about truck driving or, you know, muscle cars or something like that. But I thought about I thought about maybe because we had to use four-wheel drive vehicles to get around on Thursday. You know, was it Thursday? Thursday? Feels like it was a week. Was it a full week we were out there? I feel like. I was rather impressed with a four-wheel drive vehicle. You know, I drive a little sports car, not a snow car. Not. In fact, my grill air intake is not 12 inches high. And when the snow's 17, you know, You can actually overheat your car in a snowstorm if you clog up the radiator enough. It sounds kind of silly, but no air flowing through there. You can actually overheat in a snowstorm. I've seen it happen. So the first thing I thought about is, let's suppose, just follow me along, a bunch of guys want to go in the hills. They got their four-wheel drive vehicles out there. And they're all gathered together ready to get up in them thar hills. Well, the conversation could go into, what's the best brand truck, right? And, of course, each would talk to the merits about their particular vehicle, their brand. I know many people prefer a good old Chevy. Some people are less like the Dodges, I can tell, just by knowing people who own four-wheel drives. Some of the foreign Toyota stuff has worked its way up the list. The Land Rover is not high on the list around here due to parts and availability and such like that. Well, that could go on for a while. And then, even if they're all four-wheel drive vehicles, what kind of four-wheel drive driving are we doing? For instance, snow might require one kind of tire and other things another. In fact, there's some people who like to rock crawl. This just has to do with ever so gently working their way over rocks and acute angles and all these other things. There's another one called overlanding. That's where you just try to get out there really far to camp. You're not as worried about rock crawling, but just getting out there and bringing a lot of gear so once you get there, you can survive. So you'll see the fold-up tents on top of the vehicles and tanks and containers and also. Well, what about a mud bog? Hold it. You want horsepower. You want big tires. We're still talking four-wheel drive and all these different applications thereof. Now, let's change it by one. Let's suppose I want to move a couch. What kind of truck do I need? Just about any old one will do. If I want to move in a snowstorm, well, maybe we go back to the four-wheel drive. But why are you moving couches in a snowstorm? Though I have seen it done. It's like I moved in a boat one time in a horrible snow. I just thought, you know, stopping for a couple hours and having coffee might have been a good idea there. Public service announcement. So here you have all these different things attached to it. And when it comes right down to it, with all these different applications, if you're just trying to move a couch, well, any old truck will do. I'm actually talking about church and all the different applications and idiosyncrasies and different things different churches do on different topics. And there can be numerous on the topic of baptism, especially the topic of revelation, interpretation, end time stuff, post-tribulation, mid-tribulation, pre-wrath, you know, on and on, amillennial view of revelation, if anyone even knows what that means. It means no millennium. So the premillennial, postmillennial, and the amillennial view, a before, un or non, they look at it as being allegorical. There is no millennium. That's a view of the book of Revelation, and many churches hold to that. And you can't blame them. Interpreting all the prophetic passages involving Israel was difficult for a long time because there was no Israel. In other words, that area was still there, but Israel wasn't a nation, in a sense, and depending on who was running through and taking over at the particular time, Ottomans or World War II or whatever was going on. So all these different things, all these different arguments, when it comes right down to it, if you just want to move a couch, you just need a truck. I would say the person who just wants to go to church and sing a song to Jesus just needs a church. They may not need to know all these other details. Now, it's a good idea to study these things. It is to understand what you believe and why, or even if you don't take a stance on something, that's fine. But someone's going to not like you because you didn't take the same stance they did. Even if you don't take a stance, you're taking a stance. And this just goes on and on. Well, today I'm talking about a very difficult topic, and that is of Holy Communion. The Lord's Supper, the sacrament of the Lord's Supper, also known as Eucharist. And all sorts of things happen here, just in those words. Holy Communion, Lord's Table, the word sacrament was used, and the older word Eucharist. Eucharist is derived from the Greek word Eucharistia, which means thanksgiving, gratitude. Well, that's a fine name for it. We're being thankful for what the Lord did. I can get that. That's a good name for it. In fact, the Lord's Supper, well, it was at the Last Supper, the last, you know, that Passover meal where these things were instituted. This is my body. This is my blood. So calling it the Lord's Supper makes sense. Communion. The word communion means to be together, to interact, to commune. And other words of different translations may translate that word partaking, you know, sharing. It still involves this union. And that's a fine thing too. Also, a sacrament. Now, here's an interesting one. When you, I remember a man told me, "You're a Methodist." Yes, he says, "You believe in sacraments." I said, "Well, just two." Now, the Catholics have like seven, like last rites and marriage and some holy orders. I think is one. And but most churches nowadays two. They are. Baptism, communion. Some do include foot washing, because that was also instituted on, but most churches I know don't do a lot of foot washing. Though, if you want to have a foot washing service, we can work something out. I'm not against the idea. I just never done one, so I wouldn't really know how to do one. And my feet aren't particularly pretty. Does anyone else kind of? Somebody's really got to be a servant heart if you want to tackle these bad boys. Bring a grinder. I mean, it's going to be rough. So the guy says, "You are Methodist. You believe in sacraments." I said, "Well, baptism and communion." He says, "Those are ordinances. Those aren't sacraments. Those are ordinances." So in his mindset, if you call them ordinance, that's one thing. If you call them sacred, that's another thing. And there is that Protestant view where anything that even remotely reminds you of a Catholic is wrong. Well, I don't think Catholics were wrong on every issue. I don't. But they've been Trinitarian for a very long time. Good for you, Catholics. Good for you. On this we can agree. But the word sacrament. Sacrament is a Christian rite that is recognized, this is from Wikipedia, is a Christian rite that's recognized in being particularly important and significant. Well, so far by that description, particularly important and significant. I think sacrament's a fine word for communion and baptism. It goes on to say there are various views on the existence, number, and meaning of such rites. True. Two is very common, though. There are various views. Many Christians consider the sacraments to be a visible symbol of the reality of God, a visible symbol of something God is, as Don is doing. I think most could still agree to that. And then it says, as well as a channel for God's grace. And that's where some more debate comes on. But it says here, many denominations, including Roman Catholics, Lutherans, Presbyterians, Anglican, Methodists, Reformed, hold to the definition of the sacrament formulated by Augustine of Hippo. And of course, Augustine of Hippo, that goes way back. What was he, 350 AD, something like that? Outward sign of an inward grace. An outward sign of an inward grace that has been instituted by Jesus Christ. Sacraments signify God's grace in a way that is outwardly observable to the participants. Well, now, like with any particular verse, any particular church practice, I don't want to overdo it. Am I popping again? Is it my voice doing it? I'll try that. I'm trying to push it back a little further. It's not the batteries. I just changed them. I don't want to go too high on a particular topic, nor do I want to cut it too low. I don't want to come in under the hope and standard of cause of Christianity, nor do I want to elevate it more than Christ himself elevated it. So, Holy Communion. We found a video, we watched this two Fridays ago for Bible and Breakfast. It was on the topic of communion. Now, what everyone doesn't know, it was a 20-minute video on all sorts of different variations different churches do revolving communion. What everybody doesn't know is that was the third video in the series. That series on communion alone and talking about the different aspects and traditions and rules and codes and ideas is over an hour and 10 minutes long just to discuss Communion, Eucharist, the Lord's Supper. Some of the topics include, what do you do with the wine when it's done? You've blessed it. You've prayed for it. You've passed it out. Now, remember, there are different views on this, on how real it gets. From it's literally transformed to the body and blood of Christ, to it's purely symbolic and a memorial and a ritual, a remembrance. So what do you do with the wine? Well, I know that I've been to a Catholic one or two, and when I was there, the assistant priest, father guy, he has to guzzle down whatever's left. Not only, I mean, he had a chug. I mean, it depends on how much is left in there. You know, shotgunning whoever knows what I'm talking about. A wasted youth. Yeah, drink the rest, and it's actually a very elegant part of the ceremony as he wipes it clean and shows there's no remainder or residue left on the cloth and examines the chalice, the cup thing, to show there's no leftover. That's one way of doing it. A sacrarium. I had no idea what a sacrarium was. It's a special sink used for the reverent disposal of the sacred blood, wine. So you don't want to just take what's left over and throw it in the sewer system down the pipe. So you have a special sink design. And the one I saw kind of looked like something between a porcelain water faucet, like the old school, they're metal now, but you know, the porcelain kind of water faucet, and a urinal, but a kind of shape. Not trying to be crude, just, you know, giving you the, you know, and a silver, very ornate lid on it. And that sink was only used for the disposal of wine. And it had a drain outside to the earth. It could not return it to the thing. It goes on to say that, should you, in the Orthodox Church, should you spill some on yourself, that piece of garment must be cut out and burnt. They even said on some that if you spill some and clean it all up, you must rinse out those garments in the special sink, so even the residue from the water and the wine mixed together will go out into the earth and not into the sewer system. I would call this not just Holy Communion, but Holy, Holy, Holy Communion. I mean, this is elaborate. Well, it goes, this was all in this video. I even looked it up. We could get one in the church here for about $500. That is very beautiful porcelain one with a, well, I'm not saying we have to have one, but I looked it up online. Reverent disposal. When I went, I've told this story before, but for the, excuse me, for the newer people, I was making a food delivery to the Greek Orthodox Church in Reno. They have a big Greek festival every year, and when I was still delivering food, they ordered enough food for me to take a tractor trailer there. Well, as I went in, the gal said, put the stuff over here, and she wanted me to know if I'd pick it up and put some stuff in the refrigerator, and I don't like doing that because I'm already unloading a tractor trailer. If I pick it up for everybody else, that's twice. Mike's not going to make it to 30 at this rate, you know, moving two tractor trailers a day as opposed to one. But, you know, it's a church, and she was by herself. We had a hard time getting some of the food in it because it was full of beer, Athos beer. I thought, if I was a younger man, this would have been a cool church. That would have been a deciding factor right there. I joke. And they're having a Greek festival, and drinking's not evil. But while I was there, she said, oh, they're just finishing the altar. And she opened the door to the sanctuary area, and it was beautiful as stonework. She said, well, we had a lot of carpet in there. And if the priest father spills the communal wine, he has to lap it up with his tongue. And he can't do that on carpet. And technically, you can go back to the other rule, cut it out and burn it. But or have something that's not going to absorb it so you can get down there and lick it up. I mean, that is, again, is that four holies in front of communion now? I mean, how many holies we got going on? This is reverent. Oh, check it out. There's more. Who can receive it? The words are open communion, closed communion, and close communion. Open communion, as the church says, all who desire to take communion and have made your peace with God, take communion. Open, very open. You don't have to be. Others, closed communion. If you're a member of this church and only this church, take communion. Then there's the close one where if we're connected with other churches of the similar brand, denomination, thought, you can take one there and maybe they can take one here. That's a kind of a close communion, right? These are just some of the rules applied to communion. How old do you have to be? Well, some suggest early. What's wrong with it? Some like to make it a big deal. Your first communion. Right? Some talk about you should be old enough to understand. Well, when it comes to understanding politics, it's 18. When it comes to understanding alcohol, it's 21. Right? So how old would you have to be to really understand the things of God? You know, 10, 11, 12, 14, 18. Some people can go a long way and still not understand the things of God. Not age required. There was rules on dress. One particular church said you should definitely not wear jeans. I mean, how many holies are we stacking on top of communion now? It's just getting higher and higher. How long should you fast before you take Holy Communion? 8 hours was suggested, or the sundown the day before, kind of following the Jewish day. It also suggested, though, that should you go to a deathbed-type situation, a last rites, then maybe 2 hours is enough. And you should certainly serve communion to the person on the deathbed and anyone else in the room if they want to. There's that. And it goes on, how much, what kind of food, how much, how long, how often. Some churches twice a year, some churches once a year, some churches every Sunday. Then, of course, I already mentioned, when the priest, the father, the pastor blesses the food, does it literally become Jesus' body and blood? It doesn't look like it, but it's become it somehow in a miraculous sense, the Catholic view. Then there's one they call consubstantiation. The first one's transubstantiation. The substance has transformed. Transubstantiation. I always throw these out there, not to show off, but it's fun. Like I said, you go home at lunch, someone says, what'd you learn at church today? You go, transubstantiation, and just leave it at that. The next one's consubstantiation, with substance. People accuse Lutherans of being with substance. You know, as they were breaking away from the Catholic Church, they changed many things, and communion was one of them. It didn't literally become Jesus' body. And if it is literally becoming his body and blood, I understand the crumb catchers and keep it under lock and key and special sinks and safes, and you better eat it all up. You know, I get it, depending on how holy, how many holies you're going to stack in front of it. But it's with his presence, so it doesn't literally become him, it's with him. Then some other people say just presence. That's what more Lutherans actually say. We believe in Christ's presence. His presence is there. Not necessarily physically, but you know, in a spiritual sense, it's presence. So kind of somewhere between with substance, becoming the substance, transubstantiated with substance, with presence. And one of the more final views would simply be a symbolic memorial type act, which would be very much more of your Protestant churches nowadays. Reading from 1 Corinthians 15, verse 17. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 17. In the following directives, I have no praise for you, for your meetings do more harm than good. Now think about that. Here's the Apostle Paul. He's talking to this church. He's trying to encourage them and work out different bits and pieces and problems they're having all through the chapters. And out of most of the New Testament letters, the Corinthian church was a bit messed up. Almost every chapter is a new problem. Really, take a pen and paper sometimes, read through each chapter, just kind of for fun. What was the big issue there? You can have one or two, and you'll have an outline of almost every single chapter. There is a new problem the Apostle Paul is trying to deal with. And here in 1 Corinthians, 1 Corinthians 11, 17, whatever I said before, disregard. In the following directives, I have no praise for you. Your meetings do more harm than good. You're blowing it. Not only are you blowing it, you're counterproductive. Your meetings are doing more harm than good. What is he talking about? Communion. Let's read on. Verse 18. In the first place, I hear that when you come together as a church, there are divisions among you, and to some extent, I believe it. No doubt there has to be differences among you to show which of you have God's approval. And there's an interesting thought on what is exactly he's saying there. And one of the thoughts is there is going to be some difficulties. They're going to be, because some people are right in the Lord, some people are going to argue against it, and it's going to take some working through. That's the way many people interpret that passage, that there's going to be a frustration. Iron sharpens iron, you know, And let's skip along to the actual problem, verse 20. So then, when you come together, is it not the Lord's Supper you eat? So is it a fine to call it the Lord's Supper? It certainly is. Verse 21, for when you are eating, some of you go ahead with your own private suppers. As a result, one person remains hungry and another gets drunk. Now, if what we read was before was holy, 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 holy communion, what is this one? Well, unholy communion. This one's a party. It's a riot. They're having a rave. I mean, one person remains hungry, another one's getting drunk. What kind of commotion is going on there? Verse 22, he makes a good point. Don't you have homes to eat and drink in? Are you to despise a church of God by humiliating those who have nothing? What shall I say to you? Shall I praise you? Certainly not in this matter. You're blown it. The Apostle Paul just told you to. When we were in the book of Amos, last week it was, we ran across that verse where the offerings and the prayers and their singing meant nothing, even though they were doing all the good churchy stuff, the worshipful stuff, the temple stuff. They were worshiping, they were praying, and it meant nothing because they didn't have hearts behind it. They weren't living it out. Well, communion's the same way. And here, they're doing more harm than good when they get together. It's supposed to be about love. It's supposed to be about Christ. You're supposed to walk away in fellowship. And they're walking away more divided when they got there. What shall I say to you in this matter? Shall I praise you? Certainly not. Now, if we're talking about holy, holy, holy communion and all the rules and requirements, we're also talking about party time on Communion Sunday type of church. Those are two great extremes, right? Both church history, one in the Bible, one from all around churches around the globe based on that video I watched. That's quite a difference. Is it supposed to be holy, holy, holy? Is it supposed to be anything goes, free for all, drunken buffet? Well, and how important, how holy is the bread? Is it substance? Is it with the substance? Is it, you know, presence? Is it just symbolic? And I'm sure out there somewhere, some youth group had communion with soda and potato chips. You know, I'm sure out there somewhere. There's arguments, should the bread be leavened? I even saw one where one church suggested you could use grape juice instead of wine, but it must be fresh pressed. Can't be processed. Holy, holy, holy communion. And right on the flip side, unholy communion. So, did I take out verse 27? I didn't mean to, but also I'll read it. Verse 27. So then, whoever eats the bread and drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. Whoever eats the bread and drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. Well, this now creates certain rules. Right? I think one particular denomination calls it fencing. You fence the communion table. You make sure you say a lot of things that everybody knows. Not everyone gets to come up here. Maybe you haven't been baptized in the right church. Maybe you haven't gone through the right communion class. Maybe you haven't been to church a long time or said your Hail Marys or made it to communion or confession or whatever. But you state the rules verbally. You fence it off. But here it's saying, and if you eat it wrong, others, even a minister should not allow someone to take communion in an unworthy manner. Now, I've never actually slapped communion out of anybody's hands. I haven't. I have thought about it once or twice. I have. I'm serving communion to people who are living their lives any way they want to. And here they are taking the Lord's communion. But these are all big issues. How much do you crank it down? How much do you let it go? Where do you? So I'm hoping to find a little bit of balance here. So first, when we read this verse, you're guilty of sinning against the body and blood. I wouldn't say it's just, oh, it's just symbolic. It's just a memorial. Well, you can do it wrong and sin. You know, I don't care how bad you sing happy birthday as far as a ceremony goes, it still works. You haven't sinned. But here, you do this wrong as far as ceremony and tradition goes, you have sinned. To me, that elevates it a notch. Based on the Word of God, not on church tradition, but the Word of God. Then, verse 28, everyone ought to examine themselves before they eat of the bread and drink from the cup. Who's supposed to be doing the internal checking according to this verse? Yes. Yes. I mean, can we make a lot of rules? Can we pass out cards before you do this, don't do it? Or if you're not a member of our church, go watch us do it. The Jehovah's Witness one's interesting. They have communion once a year, but no one actually eats it. They believe it's only for the 144,000, the little flock. Though I have heard tale that every now and then someone actually grabs a bite and they wonder if he's blowing it or if he's one of the chosen. You know, you have to wonder about that. Yeah, once a year and you don't even do it. And of course, the Friends version was there are no elements. There is no, what does it look like? Do you even have is it just a prayer service? Yeah, quiet time. I've been to some of those versions of those. So yeah, and from the Quaker Friends Church tradition, technically it's low carb. There is no wine or gluten free. You know, downright vegan. All these different traditions, all these different things. So first, based on the scriptures and no one's tradition, you can sin. Based on the scriptures and no one else's tradition, you should examine yourself. Verse 29, for those who eat and drink without discerning the body of Christ eat and drink judgment on themselves. So you're sinning and you're bringing judgment upon yourself. What kind of judgment? I mean, is a lightning bolt going to hit you? Now, I haven't seen that. I've met many people who are afraid if they walk in a church door, a lightning bolt will hit them. But I've been going to church a long time, and I've seen some interesting characters roll in, and there has not been any lightning bolts. But watch what it says in the next verse, verse 30. This is why many among you are weak and sick, and a number of you have fallen asleep. You take communion in an unworthy manner. You can be weak, sick, and a number of you have fallen asleep. And usually when the Apostle Paul uses that word, he means dead. Because if it's for falling asleep, many people qualify for that on any given Sunday, whether it's communion or not. Just, you know, elbow somebody if they're snoring too loud. That's all I ask. Verse 31. But if we were more discerning with regards to ourselves, we would not come under such judgment. Do you wish to take communion? Search your heart. Do you wish to avoid sin and judgment? Search your heart. And he even goes on to say, nevertheless, when we are judged in this way by the Lord, we are being disciplined so that we will not be finally condemned by the world. We're learning things. And this is a funny one in church. I won't spend a lot of time on it, but sometimes bad things can happen. It would be completely wrong to think that, oh, that person's sinning, they got in a car accident. But I've seen stuff where guys go off and do all sorts of things. They drift out of church. They start meandering a bit more and partying a bit more, and their life goes downhill. And there's not too many of people who think that, you know, maybe they left the Lord behind and they're on their own out there. They don't have any backup. And it's you don't want to say you know for sure. You don't know God's heart. You don't know that person's heart. But I'm just saying there's been enough of those where it looks like, yeah, judgment can come in this life. That's what it looks like. We would not come under such judgment. In the same way, we're being disciplined. So then, verse 33. So then, my brothers and sisters, when you gather together to eat, you should all eat together. He's encouraged them to eat together. He's encouraged them to get right before the Lord and take communion together. He's encouraged them to judge yourself. Anyone who is hungry should eat something at home so that when you meet it together, it may not result in judgment. And when I come, I will give further instructions. There he has just explained some balance to what their communion services were doing. Matthew Henry was a famous Bible commentator back in the late 1600s into the early 1700s, way back when. And he was famous for it. Now you can find all the stuff online. It used to be you had to have a set of his volumes. He says this, the apostle rebukes the disorder of their partaking of the Lord's Supper, the ordinance of Christ. If they do not make us better, we will be apt to make us worse. If the use of them does not mend, it will harden. Upon coming together, they fall into division, schisms. Now look what he says up to this thing. Christians may separate from each other's communion, yet be charitable towards one another. That's this church and some of the other churches in town. We don't communion together necessarily, but we're certainly charitable towards one another. And then he says, they may continue in the same communion, right? But then others, they may be in the same communion, yet be uncharitable, unloving. Well, that creates schisms, tensions. You can feel it in the air sometimes when someone on this side of the room hates someone on that side of the room. He says the last schism is far worse than the first. There is a careless and irregular eating of the Lord's Supper which adds to guilt. Many rich Corinthians seem to have acted very wrong at the Lord's table, which took place at the time of the supper. The rich despised the poor. They ate and drank up the provisions they brought before the poor were allowed to partake. That some wanted while others had more than enough. What should have been a bond of mutual love and affection was made an instrument of discord and disunion. We should be careful that nothing in our behavior at the Lord's table appears to make light of that sacred institution. Let us never rest in the outward forms of worship, but look into our hearts. Now, I realize I say something like that fairly often. It's about the heart. It's not about the ritual. It's not about how loud you can sing or the worship. It's about the heart. I say that. I do. I was just sad to see that Matthew Henry stole it from me 300 years plus before I was born. Whenever you eat and drink this bread and cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Reading straight from the Free Methodist Handbook there, the Book of Discipline, it says this, the invitation, and the Free Methodist Church practices open communion. You who are truly and earnestly repent of your sins, who live in love and peace with your neighbor, and who intend to lead a new life. I like how it says it. It wants you to be on the road. It wants you to be working. It wants you to be doing what you're supposed to be doing as a Christian. Now, does it say perfection on this particular passage? No. It's an intent to lead a new life. How? Following the commandments of God and walking in his holy ways. Should you take communion today? Should you take communion today? Ask yourself the question. Do I care about the Lord's commandments? Do I care about walking in his holy ways? Then it says, if you do, draw near with faith and take this holy sacrament to your comfort, and kneeling humbly, make your honest confession to Almighty God. A prayer. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things, judge of all people, we confess that we have sinned, and we are deeply grieved as we remember the wickedness of our past lives. We have sinned against you, your holiness, and your love, and we deserve only your indignation and anger. We sincerely repent, and we are genuinely sorry for all wrongdoing and every failure to do the things we should. Our hearts are grieved, and we acknowledge that we are hopeless without your grace. Have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father, for the sake of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who died for our sins. Repeat, forgive us. Cleanse us. Give us strength to serve and please in the newness of life and to honor and praise your name through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God and Heavenly Father, who gave in love your only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption, who by his sacrifice offered once and for all, did provide full, perfect, and sufficient atonement for the sins of the whole world, we come now to your table in obedience to your Son, Jesus Christ, who in his holy gospel commanded us and to continue a perpetual memory of his precious death until he comes again. Hear us, O merciful Father. We humbly ask and grant that we, receiving this bread and the cup, as he commanded, in the memory of his passion and death, may partake of his most blessed body and blood. We will distribute the elements. Please hold on to them, and we'll take them together. So, what is the proper best way to have the Lord's Supper? With a true heart? What is the best way to have a potluck service? One where you share the word of the Lord lived out before you this day. The body of our Lord Jesus, which was given for you, preserve your soul and body into everlasting life. Take and eat this in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed upon him in your heart by faith with thanksgiving. The blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was shed for you, preserve your soul and body into everlasting life. Drink this in remembrance that Christ's blood was shed for you, and be thankful. I would say, when it comes to singing at church, not every song is my favorite. I don't even particularly care for my singing voice. And you know what? Sometimes a song moves me. Sometimes I read through parts of the Bible that are kind of thick to get through. Other times I read parts of the Bible where I go, huh. Other times the words jump off the page. I would suggest if you hang out around church enough, communion time will be one of those for you also. Let us pray. Gracious Lord, I thank you for your word. May we be followers of you and not overdo or underdo it, but just follow you truly in our hearts, worship you in spirit and in truth. I thank you for all the hands that prepared food today that we may share with those around us with loving hearts. Thank you for all that you do and remind us to do. In Jesus' name, amen. You are dismissed. Thank you.